If you want to ruffle the feathers of BMW purists all around the world, a surefire way to do that is to dump a 1,000 horsepower, 10,000 RPM RB28 into an E92 M3. We're here at World Time Attack and we're taking the opportunity to have a tech tour of Jake Jones, the DriftSquid's E92 M3 drift car. Now, at least on this side of the world, a BMW E92 probably isn't the chassis of choice if you want to be competitive drifting. And Jake has come from a background where he's had a lot of success using the popular Nissan S chassis. Asking Jake about his motives behind the BMW M3 swap, it was really just to wow the crowds and have something that really stood out both visually with that wide body M3 shape, along with the distinctive sound from his 10,000 RPM 1,000 horsepower RB28. Now, the heart of the car obviously is that Nissan RB28 engine swap. And while the RB26, the base of this engine, is incredibly popular, it's also not without its idiosyncrasies, and holding one together at that sort of RPM and that sort of power level has its problems. And this is where Jake got Powertune Australia involved. They're no strangers to the RB26 platform and have extensive experience and great results with the RB26 in a drag application. It wasn't too hard to put what they'd learned in the drag arena to work and make a reliable RB28 that's suitable for drifting. The build began with a brand new N1 block. Now that N1 block is quite popular for a performance build. It's made out of a slightly different material, although it is still a cast iron, and it's slightly stronger, particularly as the RB26 blocks are known for cracking at high RPM levels. The stroker kit itself is an off-the-shelf Tomei kit consisting of a crankshaft, rods, and pistons. The bottom end of the engine, however, is really just there to support the power, and it's the cylinder head and the turbocharger that really is the key to making that power. Again, Powertune started with a brand new casting from Nissan. It's fitted with a suite of aftermarket oversized valves, along with a set of larger cams, although I'm not quite privy to the exact specifications of those cams. The fact that they are able to make power up at 10,000 RPM suggests that they've got a lot more lift and a lot more duration than stock. Now that's actually one of the problems with the RB26 head, however, is that if you want to increase the lift significantly above stock, you actually have to machine the head to clearance the cam lobe. Obviously that's something that Powertune have done, and this has also gone along with a full CNC porting job of that head, and the valve seats have also been CNC cut to ensure absolute accuracy. Another novel modification that Powertune have applied here is to swap out the factory underbucket shim valve actuation for a single piece bucket. Now, this adds a layer of complexity because adjusting the valve lash now requires a complete new bucket assembly to be fitted. However, it ensures that at very high RPM, there is absolute reliability of the valve actuation system. There's no chance of the shim falling out and affecting the valve actuation. The turbocharger fitted to this engine is the BorgWarner 9174 turbo. Now, there's actually a very slightly larger turbo in the lineup, the 9180. And the 9174 was chosen because the team knew that they would be pushing this turbo to the absolute maximum in order to achieve Jake's target of 1,000 horsepower. As those familiar with the EFR series of turbos know, they are very fragile if you push them to a turbine speed that's too high. There is a critical speed, and if you go beyond that, you can expect the turbocharger to fail. The 9174 actually has a very slightly higher critical speed limit than the 9180, and this is why the team have gone in that direction. While we're still talking about the engine mechanical system, one of the common reasons for failure with any Nissan RB engine, particularly those that are being used in a circuit application, is with the oiling system. The factory wet sump oiling system just isn't up to task. There's numerous problems with oil surge, along with the reliability of the factory oil pump. Jake and the Powertune team completely got rid of the factory oiling system, going for a dry sump system right from the start. that dry sump system relies on an external oil pump that's driven directly from the crankshaft. This scavenges the oil out of the dry sump and then returns it into a remote oil reservoir mounted in the boot. From here, a constant supply of oil can be drawn forward by the pressure stage of that dry sump pump, and then it can be forced through the engine. This ensures that regardless what Jake's doing, and regardless what the acceleration, the braking, or the lateral G-forces are doing, the engine is always going to be supplied a reliable, high-pressure stream of oil with no chance of oil starvation. The intake side of the engine is fitted with a Hypertune plenum chamber, and this removes the factory Nissan 6 independent throttle bodies in favour of a single plenum with one single throttle body. Now, there is some argument that the individual throttle bodies can improve throttle response, but in this particular application with 1,000 horsepower and the relatively high RPM range that Jake's using while competing in a drift event, the individual throttle bodies really aren't an advantage. You can also see that that plenum is fitted with a set of 12 1000cc Bosch injectors. These are run in a staged fashion, with only six being used at idle and low load, while the second set of six injectors are staged in when the fuel demands of the engine are increased under high load and high RPM operation. Now, this also brings us to the electronics package controlling the BMW M3 and their RB28 engine. And the heart of this really is the MoTeC M150 ECU. So this controls all of the operation of the engine, including that staged injection, as well as boost control and a number of safety features that are designed to ensure that that engine is going to remain healthy for a long, reliable life. Now, when it comes to fitting an aftermarket ECU to an RB engine, one of the common problems is around the Nissan 360 degree optical trigger that's normally fitted to the intake cam. This can be a source of triggering problems that results in inconsistent fueling and inconsistent ignition. And that's obviously not what we want when you're trying to push out 1,000 horsepower at 10,000 RPM. The fix for this has been a Powertune crank trigger system, which takes an RPM signal direct from the nose of the crankshaft. This is also backed up with a synchronization pulse that comes from the camshaft, and this tells the ECU which cylinder is firing at any particular time. The M150 ECU is monitoring a number of sensors that allow it to control certain safety aspects on the engine, and in fact there's over 40 sensors fitted to the engine. One of these sensors is a flex fuel sensor, and despite the fact the engine is tuned on a dedicated E85 mix, the flex fuel sensor allows the variability of the pump E85 fuel to be taken into account with the tune, and this allows the tune to automatically compensate if the mix of E85 isn't exactly correct. On top of this, the ECU also monitors aspects such as intake air temperature and engine coolant temperature, and safety functions can be brought in to prevent any damage if either of these aspects go outside of the range that the tuner is happy with. Other aspects that the ECU is monitoring include individual exhaust gas temperature, and this allows any flow distribution between the six cylinders to be accounted for, and the fuel delivery to each of those six cylinders can be adjusted to make sure essentially that the air-fuel ratio on all six cylinders is accurate and consistent. This becomes much more important when you're really pushing an engine to the limits, such as what the team at Powertune are doing here. Backing up the M150 ECU is a MoTeC C127 dash logger. Now, this doubles as a driver display so that Jake knows exactly what's going on in the heat of battle. Now, most times he's really only going to be taking notice of the shift light there to tell him when to shift into the next gear. However, if anything goes outside of the realms of normal operation, this can also be used to bring up a driver warning, bringing Jake's attention to the fact that something isn't right, allowing him to potentially abandon a battle. The dash also doubles as a logger, and this logs all of the parameters from the M150 as well as a range of other sensors on the chassis, which can be used for data analysis and improving the state of tune of both the engine and the chassis at a later point. The engine is backed up by what is one of the most popular gearboxes for drifting, which is the G-Force 4-speed dog engagement transmission. These aren't the most refined transmission in the world, however, they are incredibly strong. That's one of the key features that's so critical if you want a reliable drift car. All of the power is then fed from that G-force transmission back to another staple of a drift car, which is the winter's quick change rear end. This allows the final drive to be quickly changed to suit the requirements of specific tracks. One of the problems Jake faced when transitioning from the popular Nissan S chassis across to the E92 BMW M3 was setting up the suspension for drifting. Now, this isn't a case of just dropping in some coilovers and calling it job done. Drifting requires a significant amount more steering lock in order to be able to be competitive. Fortunately for Jake, though, he did start this project at the same time that Wisefab in the UK brought out a complete drift setup for the E92 chassis. This consists of Wisefab uprights, front and rear. This is a full bolt-in kit, ensuring that the car was going to be competitive straight out of the gate. The Wisefab setup is also coupled to a set of Australian-made MCA coilovers. So there you go, there's the inside scoop on DriftSquid's BMW M3. And while it might not be for the purist, we personally think he's done a great job.
Like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.